as well, remotely, we've got Julia Lee, who is standing by at Bell Direct. Julia, let's start with you for a change this evening. Today, sentiment clearly risk on, but why do we sort of drift through the afternoon, you think?
Look, it's been a really good time for the Australian share market. In fact, last week was the fifth consecutive week of gains for the Aussie share market, and that means we are getting very close to hitting a multi-year high on the ASX 200. And of course, that high is at 6,150 points. I suspect as we inch closer to that resistance mark, the market will start to get a little bit nervous that perhaps we are seeing price action getting ahead of earnings growth. But I guess if we have a look at the drivers for today, that positive lead from Wall Street. Once again, we didn't see huge amounts of wage inflation in the US. So I guess some of the worries around interest rates going up faster than expected, that sort of died down. And then of course, oil prices, once again, US sanctions over in Iran saw oil prices above 70 US a barrel. So not surprising to see energy one of the best performers. But I guess coming into the afternoon, we just saw a bit of profit taking given that great runoff we've seen in Aussie stocks.
Yeah, I'm curious to get you, has been supportive for commodity prices, oil in particular, Julia. But when, to Tony's point, I mean, trade is bubbling away, geopolitical risks still pushed to the side for now, but there are some still very real concerns out there. But when it comes to U.S. earnings, I mean, has the proof been in the pudding? Now, as it draws to an end, can we say that it has lived up to expectations and therefore helping to support the U.S. market going forward?
Look, I think as an investor, you have to have a look at what's happening on the macro front. And then, of course, as you mentioned, Nadine, earnings is such a key driver of the markets as well. And I guess on the macro front, what's been driving these markets is synchronized growth, the highest growth levels that we've seen in around about 7 years. And yet there have been a few warning signals as well. If we have a look at things like Korea and export growth and PMI numbers, there are slowly some signs of a little bit of weakness creeping in. So I guess just watching those macro conditions, because when you are in an environment where inflation is rising and of course growth is rising, that's very positive for equities. The problem is when it sort of flips over and you're still seeing inflation rising but growth rolling over, and I think that's the fear for the market. And if you drill down into the US earnings, I think that's the fear there as well. I mean, earnings growth of 18% for the quarter, that's phenomenal, but the key for markets is, have we seen peak growth? Yes, the market and earnings are going to keep on growing going forward, but are they going to be able to continue at the pace that we've seen? And I think that's what the markets are struggling with at the moment over in the US. Over here in Australia, of course, we're in May confession season. And although we've seen some big blow-ups in terms of market guidance in the last week, I think there's been a lot of positive news that's come out of the confession season as well. So altogether, I think that's helped to support the local market compared to the US stock market.
So let's leave that for now. Scott Phillips, Motley Fool. Westpac today.
Yes, that was the big story.
Yeah, big story. I mean, by all accounts, pretty solid set of numbers coming from Westpac. Has it quelled some of those fears that we had out in the market a couple of weeks ago about the Westpac loan book, about some of their lending standards? Because bad and doubtful debt certainly wasn't a problem in these half-yearly results.
Yeah, a reduction of 20% in the bad and doubtful debts this quarter, or half year, sorry. It's hard because these things will only come to bear down the track. And so you always see the longer the positive economic cycle continues, the lower and lower those bad debts get, right in time for the next downturn to come, and all of a sudden we find the banks are under reserve. That's always been the case, it'll always be the case. It's the way of accounting, unfortunately. That being said, I think the results were pretty good. I think if you look at, you know, very moderate, you know, not a lot of top line growth, but kept the operating expenses well and truly in check, managed to deliver a growing profit as a result. I think, you know, like we saw about commodities companies, you know, controlling the controllables is the important part. And Westpac can't control property price, they can't control business conditions. What they can do is get decent top line growth, keep costs under control, and deliver decent profit growth. I think that's a nice combination, a really solid operational performance from Westpac.
Julia, was it solid for you? I mean, that interest margins, you're looking pretty good in comparison to what we heard from some of the other of the big banks.
Nadine, last week I said that NAB is probably going to be the worst and Westpac is probably going to be the best. And if we have a look at the half-year numbers, look, ANZ was up 4% in terms of cash profit. CBA was down 2%. NAB was down 16%. And look, Westpac was up 6%. And we have seen some of the APRA numbers probably pointing to Westpac having gained market share over the last few months. We've already seen that first quarter update, so we had a bit of a clue into credit conditions being benign. And that continued into the second quarter. And impairment costs, that they are a big number. When I look at the banks, I look at them as being cyclical. And one of the key drivers I see is that that bad debt cycle. And at the moment, we're still seeing it moving down. And that's pretty incredible, given that we did see the impairment expense down 20% to $393 million. And I guess that's the thing with markets, that things can go on so much longer than what the market expects. We were expecting, and we're talking about this ticking up, I think, 3 years ago at least. And then you mentioned the net interest margin side. I mean, to see that rising 7 basis points up to 2.17% in the type of environment that the banks are in, I think that was outstanding by Westpac. So a great result. The share price did come back a bit in the afternoon. And look, to tell you the truth, all big four banks, they're all focused in on the Australian market. They're all overexposed to that mortgage risk over here. But if I had to pick one, it would be Westpac at the moment.
Julia, before we let you go, we have had the market close happen officially. The S&P ASX 200 closing higher by 22 points. That's a gain of 0.36%. So the final figure for the 200 at 6,084.5 points. Julia Lee, Bell Direct, Orica, one weight on the market overall. Morgan's and some analysis they gave earlier today saying, look, you know, they've got a lot of expectation now riding on the next half, and that there was a lot of trust me sort of sentiment in the commentary around this half yearly result. How concerned are you about Orica going forward?
Look, if you have a look at Orica, specialty chemicals and explosives, I guess when you have a look at the commodities story, you know, it's been so positive in 2018. So Orica sort of ran up with that story. But we saw our first warning back in March, the company saying that the results would be impacted by operational issues. And look, if you have a look across the regions, Australasia did okay, but the real problem seemed to be in Latin America, where earnings was down 37%, and in other parts of the world. And I guess one of the things that really came through in these results is that explosives are in oversupply. So in terms of balancing that market, I'm not sure if half a year is going to be enough time for Orica to be able to deliver and bounce back. But indeed, in terms of their guidance, they were forecasting that they would reach the upper end of their volume guidance. So look, I think there is a risk that we could see a downgrading in the second half, given the oversupply in the explosives market that we're seeing at the moment, but they did stick to their full-year volume guidance.